Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Mrinmay Pramanik. I teach Comparative Indian Language and Literature at the University of Calcutta. Today we will discuss a module on Canadian Francophone writing, and the focuses will be on novel. And this module is prepared by Rindon Kundu, research scholar, Jadavpur University. In this module, we'll talk about the French-Canadian novel before 1837, French-Canadian literature from 1837 to 1900, and French-Canadian literature from 1900 to 1940, 1940 to 1968, and from 1968 to present time. And then we will summarize the module. This module starts with defining term French-Canadian and Quebecois, which are sometimes used interchangeably, but they are not entirely the same. Jonathan Weiss and Jane Moss, in their book French-Canadian Literature 1996, have noted that the term French-Canadian most appropriately refers to the literature of Quebec, as well as refers to the literature of French Canada. That is the entire Quebec and other French-speaking parts of Canada before 1960s. At this time, there was strong nationalist sentiment running throughout Quebec, and the adjectival French term Quebecois has replaced the term French Canadian. We will jot down the history of Quebec and literature of Quebec and put forward questions like whether the literature that is coming out of Quebec region are not a branch of Canadian literature. If we go by the language of the literary text, then should we bracket them as a part of French literature? Now, let us talk about or address such question or the such issues throughout this module. This module will begin with a quotation which problematize the French-Canadian identity. Jean Bottillette, in his seminal book titled Les Canadiens Francais et son Table, The French-Canadian and His Table, published in 1972, wrote, I quote, "The Canadian identity is a mirror which reflects the image of the other when we look at ourselves in it. In other words, the French Canadians want to present themselves directly rather than representing through the mirror of our homogeneous Canadian identity. For this, the French speakers, especially those involved in literature and cultural fields, redefined themselves as Quebecois, and around 1970s, this adjectival term becomes a vehicle of nationalist identity. The vast literature that is coming out of Quebec shows that there are things common, common reality, common themes, and above all, a common language, French, which can give the Quebec literature its own identity. In spite of having differences in writing, the term Quebec literature demands its separate entity vis-a-vis English-Canadian literature. Quebec literature at the present time has been given diverse names like Francophone literature of Canada or North American literature written in French. Now, throughout this module, we will address or we'll talk about the Francophone novels based on this quotation or this idea which is formulated here. French-Canadian literature before 1837. Etymologically, the term French-Canadians get their name from the state itself, Canada, which originally referred to the land area along at St. Lawrence Rives, which was divided in three districts. From 1535 to 1960, the French word Canadian was referred to the First Nation, the predominant indigenous people in Canada, south of the Arctic, whom the French people have encountered in the St. Lawrence River Valley at Stadacona and Hochelaga, two villages at modern-day Quebec. At the end of the 17th century, Canadian became an ethnonym distinguishing the inhabitants of Canada from those of France. After World War I, English Canadians appropriated the term Canadian, and French Canadians identified as Quebecois instead. The term French Canadian is still used in general historical and cultural context, or when it is necessary to refer to Canadians of French Canadian heritage communally, such as in the name and directive of national organizations which serve Francophone communities across Canada. Francophone Canadians of non-French Canadian origin, such as immigrants from Francophone countries, are not frequently tagged by the term French Canadian. Usually, the more general term Francophones is employed for French-speaking Canadians across all ethnic origin, like Quebec, Acadians, Franco-Albarans, Francois, Franco-Colombians, Franco-Manitobans, Franco-Ontarians, Franco-Iconis, Franco-Nunavois, Franco-Tenois, etc. French-Canadian literature before 1837, to describe it in a nutshell, has never go beyond the colonialist, missionary, evangelist, rational-like Latin American literature. French-Canadian literature from 1837 to 1900. The year 1837 is important because of the famous historical event, the Rebellion of 1837. Following this, there were two other major events that shaped the Quebec consciousness: the Canada Act of 1840 and the British North American Act of 1867. But apart from these two other major events, like making of constitution and construction of railroads, have not influenced the Quebec literature around 1840s, Francophone Canadian literature distanced itself from the mainstream Canadian literature and restricted itself within the bounds of Quebec. These French Canadians defined themselves a separate entity from both the British Canadians as well as the French of France. At that time, very little fiction started to be published in newspaper columns. Stories of folklores, legends, oral tradition, ghosts, adventures, etc. started to appear in print medium. In the newspaper, La Armée du Peuple, George Boucher de Boucherville published a short story titled Trafalgar Tower in 1835, grotesquely quixotic, concerning an uncanny adventure on a tempestuous Montreal night. In the year 1837, a French-Canadian writer, Philippe Ignace Francois Aubert du Gaspé, wrote a novel titled El Influence d'un Evo, The Influence of a Book. Although the book was not well received initially, it has come to be recognized as a major landmark in terms of Canadian literature, especially Francophone Canadian literature. It is the story of Charles Amand's pursuit for gold. Between alchemy, the courtship of his daughter Amelia, the legend of Rose La Tulipe, and the assassination of the peddler Guillemette, there is a sardonic premise intended for spiritual dearth in Quebec. The author himself wrote in the preface of the novel, "I offer to my country the first novel of Canadian life, the pure ways of life of our countryside are a vast mine to explore. Perhaps I will have given birth in some of my fellow citizens, abler than am I, to the desire to enrich this country." Though the author claims that this novel has been written after Balzac's realism, the plot has nothing of that sort, and it also lacks structure and verisimilitude. In 1840, Joseph Dautre wrote Les Fiancés de 1812, The Fiancés of 1812, an adventure fiction which deals with the social issues like family, immigration, but the book is condemned and considered immoral by the Catholic clergy. Critics have accused that his novel is rather poorly constructed, poorly written, and poorly edited. Patrice Lacombe wrote a novel titled La Tere Peternele, published in 1846, which was more simple and realistic and voiced for the farmer's right. Pierre Joseph Olivier Chauveau's novel Charles Guerin, published in 1847, portrays young Quebecois in the 1820s who were disgusted with the rule of the English and hungry for establishing autonomous society in the eastern townships. The style is very high, as is the language of the main characters. However, the author regularly speaks inhabitants with the local languages, sometimes explaining certain expressions of deformations of popular words. Anthony Jerome Lejeune novel in two parts, Jean Rivard Le Défricheur, Jean Rivard the Pioneer, 1862, and Jean Rivard the Economist, 1864, depicts the overpopulation and lack of job opportunities for the new generation of French Canadians. While the first draws a romantic, optimistic futurist vision and nostalgia for an idealist post, as well as a glorified picture of French-English clashes in New France, the second tells an economic reality of the present day. There are a few novels that falls under the genre of historical novel, like Les Intendants Bigots by Joseph Marmet and Thomas Chappé's Les Marquis de Montcalm. Critics have commented that the trend of the French-Canadian fiction around the middle of the 19th century was intransigent, conformist, and utterly idealistic. Historical and the urban life was completely absent, whereas Quebec was slowly transforming towards metro society. An institution that influenced French-Canadian writing, critical thinking, and culture, named Institut Canadien de Montreal, was founded on 17 December 1844 by a group of 200 young liberal professionals in Montreal, Quebec, and Canada. The institute provided a public library and debating room for its members. One of the most prominent writers of the late 19th century is Laura Cannon, pen name of Maria Luce Félicité Angers, who is French Canada's first women novelist in its true sense. She penned around 4 autobiographical novels and 3 historical. Amongst the Angeline de Montbrun is the most popular and critically acclaimed. It is a psychological tale, first of its kind in the entire oeuvre of Canadian literature, written in a very complex narrative structure, which is unique in the Canadian literature produced in 19th century. Except this novel, the entire 19th century Francophone Canadian literature has been tagged by the critics as a dozen good class C books. But the importance of the 19th century French Canadian literature lays in the fact that it has defined it as a national literature, instilled certain sense of nationhood into it, and a confidence that French Canadian literature can be tagged as a separate independent entity on which the 20th century Quebec literature can stand on its own. So we in this part we discussed about the beginning of the novel and the very beginning of the different literary forms with the introduction of print culture in this Francophone Canadian literary world. Now let us talk about the Francophone French Canadian literature from 1900 to 1948, and before this we have discussed the beginning of the era of novel. Critics have compartmentalized pre-1837 period as pre-literary. 19th century is an affirmation of literary identity, and 20th century is the maturity period of Francophone Canadian literature. As 19th century French Canadian literature has been seen as a reactionary for its over-dependence on idealism and romanticism, 20th century French Canadian literature is utterly cosmopolitan as Quebec was becoming rapidly urbanized. At this outset, a group of poets formed the Montreal Literary School to meet and read their verse. Despite the rise of French Canadian poetry, the 20th century French Canadian literature was marked by fiction, especially novel. It has seen in every corner of the world that the rise of novel is directly proportionate to the growth of the middle class, and the same happened at Quebec also. With this, there was an increase of readership, and the Catholic Church has started to influence the development of novel a great deal. Louis Hamon, a French who came to Quebec, is the first author who has created a true picture of the Canadian countryside. His novel Maria Chapdelaine, 1914, became hugely popular in international market. The theme of the novel is deeply regionalist, portraying a peasant literature depicting rural life. This novel has a major influence on Félix Antoine Savard, a renowned Canadian folklorist who has explored Charlevoix's countryside, and it became the setting of his most popular novel titled Master of the River, 1937. A hallmark of Quebec literature till date, both Maria Chapdelaine and Menuad Matria River were immensely successful, not only in terms of monetary, but set an example of describing countryside, everyday life in village and picturesque setting. Claude Henri Grignon, a contemporary novelist, has declared, which can be seen as the manifesto of the time, notre culture sera absolument paysanne, ou elle ne sera pas. Ours will be an absolutely peasant culture, or it will not be. His novel, The Queen, 1918, painted an explicit image of rustic pastoral lifestyle. Ringwit, the pseudonym of Philippe Panayton, another contemporary, maps out in his novel 30 Acres, 1938, the transformation of life of a French Canadian native from rural richness to urban adversity in a New England mill town. A German gouvernante, one of the prominent women writers of early 20th century, published in 1945. Her novel titled Les Servantes, The Outlander, which gives a balanced depiction of peasant life. The sequel titled Mary Didache also explored marriage and the hardship of life in rural Quebec. The death of loved ones and the comforts of religion and the formidable and sometimes terrifying power of nature. Around 1930s, with the growth of Quebec City, the urban life became a major theme in the upcoming novels. Jean-Charles Herbet's Les Demi-Civilisés, The Half-Civilized, 1934, is considered as the first major urban novel in French-Canadian literature, but it was banned by the church for being political, as it claims right for free speech and liberation from clerical censorship. Roger Lemelin's The Town Below, 1944, and The Plouffe Family, 1948, both are set in the city of Quebec and portrays the everyday life of middle-class urban family. Gabriel Roy's The Tin Flute, 1945, has been considered the best urban novel of that time, and it portrays the urban working-class people of Quebec society. His next novel, The Cashier, 1954, follows the same tradition of urban-based writing, but this time Roy has depicted the social economical matrix of a white-collar job as it is based on an ordinary bank cashier. Gabriel Roy's writing has marked an era, a major shift from rural life to urban city, from idealism to true realism, and he has been considered as the best writer of Francophone Canadian literature. This is the new fiction that breaks away from French and European literature and becomes as true Quebecois but not regionalist, anchored in a North American reality but universal in its appeal. So through this very beginning of the novel, the second phrase of the beginning of the French-Canadian novel from 1900 to 1938, we came to know the emergence of urban-centric novel and the demand of free speech through the novel practice and the church's protest against it, that church banned it. So we came to know about the very growth of the beginning of the growth of the novel in French-Canadian literature. Now, let us talk about the French-Canadian literature from 1948 to 1968 and the situation of novel in this literary context. The reason behind compartmentalization of French-Canadian literature at the year of 1948 is the publication of manifesto titled Global Refusal, issued by a group of 16 writers and artists, which declares the artistic declaration of complete independence. Annie Herbert's The Silent Rooms, 1958, is a close introspection of an individual's life dust over the city, 1953, is set against the backdrop of a mining town. Yves Thériault is an important figure of this phase of French-Canadian novel. His novel, like The Ugly Girl, 1950, Agagook, 1958, are different types of psychological texts which were not limited to Quebec but about universal human being. The tradition of introspective novel has progressed with novelists of this period like Claire Martin, author of Bittersweet 1960 and In an Iron Glove 1965, and the author of Amadeo 1963, and Monique Bosco, author of Un Amour Maladroit, A Clumsy Love, 1961, etc. Around mid-20th century, there was a new kind of writing called new novel, emerged in France, which was broadly termed as anti-novel. Following the theories of Alain Robbe-Grillet and other French proponents, this avant-garde writing marked a radical departure from the conventions of traditional novel, as it ignores such elements as plot, dialogue, linear narrative, and human interest. Starting from the premise that the potential of the traditional novel had been exhausted, the writers of new novels sought new avenues of fictional exploration. In their efforts to overcome literary habits and to challenge the expectations of their readers, they deliberately frustrated conventional literary expectations, avoiding any expression of the author's personally preferences or values. Gerald Bass's Not for Every Eye, published in 1960, is the ideal example of this transition in writing. Here, Bassett leaves the judgment to the reader as he ends the novel rather openly. Bassett rather was interested in the act of writing itself. Howard Akuin's next episode, 1965, is a classic example of this kind of writing, where on the surface it is an adventure novel, but a deeper analysis will show it as a story of an imprisoned revolutionary. Jacques Ferrand, the most original voice of this era, amalgamates the social reality of modern Quebec with Indian legends. For example, Dr. Cotnoyer, 1962, The Night, 1965, The Juneberry Tree, The Sky of Quebec, etc. Roch Karis has experimented with oral tradition in his most famous novel, La Gure Yesa, 1968, and his storytelling capacity was further expanded in his two more important works, Is It the Sun, Philibert, and There Is No Country Without a Grandfather. Jacques Godbout L'Aquarium was written in 1962 against the backdrop of the revolution tranquille and the knife on the table. Represents the voice of Quebec youth. Marie Claire Blaise, one of the most prominent women writers of contemporary Canada, portrayed personal fictional world in her very first novel, A Season in the Life of Emmanuel, 1966. So this brief period of 20 odd years has been a quantum leap, not only in terms of social, political and economical changes, but a radical change in creative writing and imagination on which newer landscapes will be drawn in the next decade. So through this discussion of this era of novel from 1948 to 1968, we have observed the remarkable and revolutionary changes in the theoretical perspective of a literary criticism of novel, and the emergence of new thoughts and new genres in novels, the very emergence of that manifesto of global refusal, and the emergence of new genre of novel like new novel or anti-novel was very much remarkable, which made the communication between France-Canadian literature and the French literature itself. So this period was very much remarkable and influential. Now let us talk about the novel of 1968 to the present time. The next two decades have seen a topsy-turvy political situation. The quest for identity is a recurring theme in terms of Quebec literature, which was championed in Anne Haworth's Kamouraska, 1970. Régine Ducharme's experiment with wordplay and fantasy in his novels like A Pun on the Word Equivoque, 1967, A Pun on the Word Amertume, meaning bitterness, 1968. And the Christopher Columbus's Daughter, 1969, Wild to Mild, 1973, a wordplay on the words infants, children, and ghost, 1976, and Divide, 1990. Wolan de Villemier, a noteworthy female voice of contemporary time, experiments with violence, body, sexuality, and mysticism in a novel such as Life in Prose, 1980. Denise Bombardier, another female voice, has written probably the best novel on the topic of education, Une Enfance à Lieu, Venite, 1985. So these themes show that the present Quebec literature is not engulfed into the boundary of nationalism, rather exploring newer issues. So in the 1968 to present time, novel is a matter of experimentation also, which actually have been started from 1948 to 1968. In this period, it brought the different kind of experimentation in the writing of novel and literature as a whole, and that was carried in from 1968 to present time. And this time, remarkably, the remarkable observation of this time is the observation of body, sexuality, and women's subjectivity and women's position in society, culture, politics, and history through the practice of novel. Now, let us summarize the model. In conclusion, it could be argued that modern Quebec literature is a vibrant, diverse, innovative, experimental, creative literary corpus. We have dealt with the political, social, and economical changes in Quebec and informed the readers about the storytellers, writers, and the cultural history of French Canada. Finally, we have traced the development of French-Canadian literature with special focus on novel, categorizing them in the blocks of time as they evolved. So for further discussion on the topic, you can consult the reference list and furthermore list with the links of websites, necessary websites provided here. And for self-assessment, you can consult the self-assessment file. Thank you.